Welcome to Around the Clock, August edition. We're in the middle of the summer, enjoying the heat, and always a little concerned about our water restrictions here in Ashland. And to help you take care of those concerns, we have some guests who we're going to be speaking with about our water and our stages here in Ashland. We also have a representative from the Finance Committee. We have someone coming to talk to us about some issues that are related to our schools, and then we have a special guest later in the show. Oh, and of course, we have our ever-popular Around the Town tour, which is pretty full this week. And then, of course, we have our Selectman's Update. So, stay with us, and we'll be right back with Selectman's Update. Welcome back to Around the Clock and Selectman's Update. Since our last show, there have actually been two Selectman's meetings. One was very short. That one was on July 20th, when the main focus of that meeting was a joint meeting with our school committee to appoint a new member to the school committee. A member had to step down after the election in May, and Erin Williams has now been appointed to the school committee, and she has jumped in with both feet as she has put herself or is this one of the school committee representatives to the override study committee. Our big meeting was on August 5th. We started at 7 o'clock and we were there very late, but we had a lot of good things going on. The first was a transfer license for a class two for Middlesex Auto Reconditioning. They're an auto sales company at 220 Elliott Street and they're just changing hands. If you're looking for some used cars, they could maybe help you out. We also had Shay's Liquor come before us. They are in the plaza across from Shaw's near the old Nello's, and they are expanding their store, their liquor store, all types of liquor, and they are expanding their floor area, almost doubling in size. So those renovations should be happening soon. And the next thing we talked about was our next hearing, and this was for Las Cobos Mexican Grill and Cantina. Yes, all the conversation about what was going on in Nello's is confirmed. It's going to be a Mexican restaurant. It's going to be a restaurant that serves beer and wine and alcohol. They will have a full-service liquor license, and they are hoping to open at the end of September. I know it's been a lot of discussion as to what's going in there, so now it's confirmed, and we hope that they do well. It's a local family that's moving in and taking over that restaurant. So another nice sit-down restaurant, Mexican restaurant in Ashland, is very welcomed. We also had a visit by Susan Nickel from the Metro West Visitors Bureau, and she was telling us about MetroFest, which is a food truck and arts festival that happens this year on September 26th at Bowditch Field. And they, because it's the Metro West Visitors Bureau that is putting it on, they're looking for participation from the different communities. So Ashland has decided to participate, so we'll be able to have a tent at the festival and talk about all the great things that are going on here in Ashland, from our festivals, the farmers market, and great businesses that we have. And then we're also going to be able to do a presentation on the stage. So we're going to be reaching out to arts organizations and other people who might be willing to participate and be part of that 45-minute performance. We also had an update from Philip Williams, who is our energy manager, talking about all the different things that he and the staff that he works with have been doing to work on our energy consumption. We are a green community, so our goal is to decrease our energy consumption in many ways. He talked about the electrical vehicles that we have. He's talked about the solar initiative that we've been doing, as well as just simple things as getting people to turn their computers off in different offices around town over the weekend. All of those things are helping us save energy and we'll get our numbers down, which have been required to do. We also got an update from Joel Arbeitman from the Upper Charles Trail Committee. They have three special areas that they were focusing on that they're looking for the selectmen to either give them some assistance or just talk about. And if you're interested, make sure you go to the town website and check out the pathway of the Upper Charles Rail Trail. It is going to be connecting with four or five other communities, and when it's completed, the goal is to have a 30-mile loop that you can start at one point and go completely around on the loop. So it could still be a while, but we're working toward that. They also are looking for friends of the trail. So if you're interested in creating a trail and helping fundraise to get some of it done and help promote it, please go check it out. We accepted some minutes and approved those. We also did some appointments. Our Stormwater Advisory Committee, which is tied into our connection and looking at our connection to the MWRA, we appointed three more members, and these are members from other committees who are now part of this. So we had Paul Weincheck from the Conservation Committee, Gene Walker from Open Space and Recreation, and Mary Mortensen from the Board of Health, who will be participating in those discussions. Then we have our Water Policy Committee, and that is Jeffrey LeMay and Kathy Rooney, again, also tied into the MWRA and how we can put in good policies related to our water usage. We also went through a number of appointments, just renewing people who had been expiring at the end of August. There are a few town manager appointments. There is a new part-time circulation staff person at the Ashland Public Library. We also have a new assistant planner coming on at the end of August. And we reappointed all our auxiliary police. And you think, what are the auxiliary police? Those are the police officers who are auxiliary, so they're unpaid. They're volunteers who, on their own time, go and get training. And they are there at the farmer's market helping out, at church on Sunday mornings, at the Boston Marathon, the Ashland Marathon. Anytime you might need someone extra, or we need someone extra, they're always there at Ashland Day. So our auxiliary police officers are Sergeant Smith and Sergeant Doucette, and then officers Porter, Cunningham, Grace, Foodie, and McDonald. And we thank them for their service as auxiliary officers. We also discussed a number of toll roads, and those toll roads are fundraisers for different organizations. The Greater Ashland Lions have one coming up, the Ashland Lions have one coming up, and the Ashland Fire Department have one coming up. We also opened the warrant for the fall special town meeting. Believe it or not, November will be here before you know it. So that has now been opened, and if there are committees looking to put a warrant on the town meeting, an article on the town meeting warrant, they should go ahead and submit those. There's forms online as to how those should be submitted. We have also opened up our Board of Selectmen BAA grant program for the fall. So those applications, again, are also on the Ashland Mass website, and those are being accepted until the end of September. And then we'll be giving out the grants in the second meeting in October. We got an update from the Override Study Committee. The Outreach Group Subcommittee from the Override Study Committee has been doing some meetings trying to get input from the community. We also talked to some about some traffic inputs that are going on Clinton and Olive Streets from Legacy Farms. No decisions have been made, but we discussed the traffic issues there. We discussed parking issues on Chestnut Street, people parking where there's no parking, and it's getting dangerous. So be on the lookout for some changes possibly in some parking policies and some signage just to try and keep our streets a little bit safer, but also just be aware of the extra traffic that we have in town. Then we also had some updates from the town manager regarding the Cadillac Paint. That's a property over on Elliott Street on the other side of 126. We're getting some funds to do some work to clean that up area. That area up, there'll be a meeting later in the fall, talking to the residents and just communities, people who want to have input and as to what we could possibly do with that space. The Rail Transit District, which is the area up around the train station, still has some momentum, still is moving forward, so be on the lookout for that. If you check out Co-Urbanize on the town website, once it gets up and going, you can follow the process there. Warren Woods, there was an article in the paper regarding the encroachment. We're almost done getting everything cleaned up, and once that's done, then we can sign the conservation restriction with Mass Audubon, and that will actually bring some funds back to Ashland to help maintain Warren Woods and keep it clean. We had a couple of other updates, but those were the big things. And that was it. We will not be having another formal meeting until the first week in September, which will be September 2nd. But we have other things going on. We were just approved for the Community Compact, which is a new program put out by the state for communities to get additional resources and funding and assistance on specific initiatives. And we've been approved for that. And that's really it. So that was it for the Selectman's update for August. As always, we're around. Things are still going on. But That's it for this one. Stay tuned and we'll be back with more Around the Clock. Come join us for Yoga in the Park on Friday, August 28th from 6 to 7:30 at the gazebo at Stone Park. The class is a fundraiser to help raise money for the fireworks for the 30th Ashland Day celebration. The cost, $10 per person, $5 for children, and a $20 cap for families. You can also purchase a t-shirt for $20 and use that as your ticket to get into the class. Tickets and t-shirts are available at the Red Dress in downtown Ashland. Welcome back to Around the Clock. I have a guest with me today from the Finance Committee. We try to bring in different members from different committees. We have Adam Elbert. Adam, welcome to Around the Clock.
Thanks for having me, Yolanda.
As I mentioned, I try to bring in members of different committees. We've never had you on Around the Clock, so thank you for being here.
You're welcome. Glad to be here.
And I want to talk a little bit about you,
sure.
Your role on the Finance Committee, and some other different things.
Sure.
So first, tell us a little bit about yourself, Adam. How long you've been in town, what you do, things like that.
Sure. So my family and I moved to Ashland in 2010, so we've been here about 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
We'd lived in Shrewsbury for about 13 years before that. I have two kids in the schools, one in the Warren School and one in the high school. And my background is I'm an electrical engineer, and I currently work at MIT at Lincoln Laboratory in Lexington.
Wow, okay. So what brought you to Ashland? What made you want to live here?
It was much closer to the city where most of the jobs are. At the time, I was commuting into Cambridge and...
From Shrewsbury.
From Shrewsbury.
Oh,
wow. So that was a very long ride.
Yeah.
My wife also commutes into Cambridge still today, so mm-hmm. she is out very early in the morning. So the ride was a lot shorter, and we were looking for a small town community that had the look and feel with lots of different amenities. And Ashland really hit home as a community where everybody really cares about what goes on. The schools are very strong, and there's a lot to do in the area. So we were very happy to find a place here.
Okay, and what led you to volunteering and being on the Finance Committee?
Well, I thoroughly blame my wife for that. She said to me, and I quote, "You can't complain if you're not going to do something about it."
Good point.
So I got involved, started working in some of the education areas. I ran for school committee, and I'm currently the president of the Ashland Education Foundation.
Okay.
And as part of that, I got to know the town moderator, Adam Schuster, who asked me to fill a vacant seat on the Finance Committee. And I'd always wanted to better understand how Ashland appropriates its money, why it gives money here and not there,
mm-hmm.
and to be able to hopefully, provide some useful input from an engineering perspective to figure out, can we do things a little better? Are there things where we can see some efficiencies and maybe, help out in some of those types of areas?
Okay. On Finance Committee, so you're coming at it from a different background. A lot of people who are in finance have either finance background or a business background. So you're coming at it from an engineering. How do you think that helps you as a member of FinCom?
I ask a lot of questions that usually start with why.
Okay.
And from my perspective, I'm always looking for things that, can we partner with another community? Are there things that we can do where departments work together or take advantage of either synergies or commonalities between what two places are trying to do so that we can gain some efficiency, gain some money back, and be able to reroute it somewhere else. I also ask some questions, from the technology side of things that I have familiarity with. And one of the things that I think makes the committee so interesting is that there are such a diverse group of people on it. Everyone kind of has their own area of expertise that they can ask questions from, and that allows us to really, poke holes into straw man type of budgets and ask a lot of questions so that at the end of the day, Mr. Schiavi and Mr. Herbert really feel like that all those budgets and have been vetted out and people have gotten their questions answered so that they can move forward and do the right thing by the town.
Now, how long have you been on the Finance Committee?
I joined the Finance Committee in May, and that was May of 2014.
I was going to say, it's been over a year,
yes.
I know that, okay.
And actually, the person whose term that I filled expired in May, and I was recently reappointed to another 3-year term by the moderator. So starting fresh again this May.
Good, good. Now, there's been a lot, maybe not a lot, but there's been discussion that the Finance Committee in Ashland might not be doing all that it needs to. How do you feel that your role, either as a member or just the Finance Committee in general, is working and doing their job, working with town management and the school administration?
Sure. So in our meetings, we meet with every department, every board, and every committee. We go through all of their budgets to understand what it is that their needs are, what it is that they're asking for. You know, in a lot of cases, some of the budgets can be very complicated, and in particular, it's things like, if we spend money up front, we'll see a long-term savings, so we'd like to do that, and then we have to balance that against the, you know, available cash flow from a town perspective that says, well, if we have the money, that's a great idea, but if not, we may have to put something like that off to a longer-term project. Mm-hmm. The town, I think, under Mr. Schiavi, has done a great job of really taking formal process and applying it to the budgeting side of things, you know, especially when you start looking at capital expenditures, which has now right. come under that type of a process as well. And we've applied a lot of rigor to this analysis side of things so that we really understand the different pieces of the budget and are trying to make the best recommendations possible. You know, I hate to say the school side versus the town side. It's really one town. We right. have lots of different boards and committees. Obviously, the school takes up a large piece of the budget, but the goal is for all of those boards and committees to have their needs met, and by doing that, meeting all of the needs of the people in the town.
Right. What do you think makes a good finance committee member?
You have to be a good listener,
okay.
And you certainly have to be a good reader. We hear from a lot of different people. You know, people come to the finance committee meetings, and obviously anybody is welcome to come and give mm-hmm. us their opinion and their thoughts. If they feel a particular board or entity is underfunded, we'd like to know about it. If they feel they're overfunded, we'd like to know about it. Especially if they see particular needs that they feel may not have been represented in a budget that was presented or that just hasn't made its way to us from a knowledge perspective, we want to hear from the people within town so that we're making the best decisions possible.
Good. Now, the reason I asked that question is I know you're currently down or going to be down a member.
That's true.
On the FinCom. So hearing from a current member what it takes might make people think, oh, that might be something interesting. So,
yeah, I mean, there's obviously a time commitment. We meet with fairly regular schedules. You know, the people on the board are very committed so that we can, as I said, make the best decisions possible.
Right.
Obviously, when I came in, I had no idea what I was doing, at least in terms of how the committee itself worked.
Right.
So, you know, I was taken under the wing by, I would say, Dan and by Jack and all the other members of the committee. And, you know, we're happy to help out anybody that's willing to come and devote the time necessary to help out in these types of issues. You know, people move out of town, people have health issues. So we're always looking for new folks that are willing to help come in and contribute.
Right. Do you have a personal goal in regards to maybe this current fiscal year, in regards to your role in the Finance Committee?
Sure. Well, I think everybody knows we had a very tough budget season this past year. We had to make some very difficult cuts. Expenses are rising. They're not going down. So,
right.
you know, we're expecting the next budgeting season to be even more difficult. Obviously, there's been talk about a number of different ways, and we're exploring as a committee anything we can do to try and save money, improve efficiency. But one of the conclusions that I think both the Finance Committee, the School Committee, and the Board of Selectmen have come to is that there's still not enough out there that can be saved or any sort of partnerships that can be exploited where we're going to get enough money to maintain the status quo.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, we need to start looking at alternatives. And if that means, you know, looking at an override, then that's what we're going to do.
Right.
Obviously, with an override, there's a lot of concerns. Can people afford the tax increase? Especially with our seniors, we have a very, very large senior population,
yeah.
disproportionate to some of the other communities in our vicinity, a lot of whom are on fixed income. And, you know, I know it's very difficult for them to carry an increased tax burden. You know, just because my property increases in value doesn't mean I have more income to pay
right.
those taxes.
Exactly.
So, you know, investigating circuit breakers and other sort of ways to relieve that burden from our seniors and the low-income families means that we have to shift that around. But we still want to be able to offer a top-notch school system. We want to offer the most important amenities within town, you know, a senior center that's as great as it always has been and
right.
continue to be that way. You know, we have Department of Public Works that's incredible in what they do. Police and fire are finally fully staffed. We want to keep them that way. And unfortunately, you know, at some point you have to say if we want to have all of these services and amenities, that means that we may have to put more money on the table. So everybody's kind of got to belly up and put a little bit more down.
Right. Right.
So.
Okay. Good. Well, before I let you go, and sure. I appreciate your information and your insight, and I look forward to maybe having you back again,
sure.
maybe in the midst of the budget season.
Of course.
This is your first time on my show, and I have a question I ask all first-time guests,
okay.
and the question is, is there something about you, Adam Elbert, that you're willing to share that many people or some people in Ashland may not know?
Sure. I am an avid baseball fan. And going back to childhood days, I've always been a baseball card fan.
Ooh.
And much to my wife's dismay, my basement is filled with baseball cards.
Do you have any important ones? Or
I collect some of the more valuable ones from the early 50s. And, you know, I absolutely enjoy going back and looking at those cards, seeing players that I never got to see except on film or on TV. Mm-hmm. And I'm excited to show that to my kids and be able to kind of raise them in the baseball tradition.
Cool. Now, can I ask, who do you root for?
So I grew up in Massachusetts. I went through the 78 debacle and gave up on the Red Sox. My parents moved me to New York without any choice.
Uh-oh.
And I couldn't give up the Red Sox for the Yankees, so I ended up becoming a Mets fan.
Oh.
So my wife kind of tolerates that because she's a Red Sox fan.
Okay.
And she says it's not as bad as it could be. But
right. At least
I'm
it's not,
not
the
happy.
Yankees.
That's right.
Good. Well, Adam, thank you so much for being on
thank
Around
you.
The Clock. That's it. Hold on, and we'll be right back with more Around the Clock. Welcome back to Around the Clock. We have two more guests with us today. This time we've gone into employees of Town Hall. We have Dave Manoogian all the way on my left, who you've met before. And then we have a new guest, Roy Correa, who works with also in Public Works, and he is our Water and Sewer General Foreman. Gentlemen, welcome to Around the Clock.
Thank you.
Now, I brought you on for a specific reason. It's summer, and water is on everyone's mind, or lack thereof, potentially. but before we get into the water, Roy, you haven't been here before. Welcome to Around the Clock.
Thank you very much.
And can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Well, basically, I've been with Ashland going on 13 years. When I first started here, I actually started at the water treatment plant. So that was my first role in treatment as far as water. I've always been in the other end of it, which is distribution. And then I slowly came back into distribution, and I started learning more about sewage too, because we're also a combined system here, water and sewer. And eventually I worked my way to general foreman, and I've had a great experience all the way up to that point.
Good. Well, we brought you on for your experience and your expertise, so we're going to ask you some questions. So first, talk to us a little bit, Roy, about what is our water treatment plant like, and how is it affected by the reservoir?
Well, our water source is shallow wells. A lot of people think we're surface water. We're not. We don't get water from the surface. We have wells. We have five wells, and they're about in the 30-foot range. And, of course, we have to draw from it. We have a permit from the state. And once we reach a trigger level, we can't draw anymore. Or if, when the reservoir level starts to get low, our wells also get low. So that's another reason sometimes we have our water bans. Mm-hmm. And it's different stages. We have our regular odd even, then we have a stage one, stage two ban. And David, you might be able to give a little more information as far as the levels for stages, if you'd like.
Sure. So when the treatment plant was built in the late 90s, and as Roy said, we have the five wells there, we negotiated with the state, both with the DEP and other agencies such as Department of Conservation and Recreation, who manages the Hopkinton Reservoir, to make sure that we could use our wells, but they would still be able to comfortably use the facilities that they have. So as many people are familiar with, Hopkinton Reservoir has a beach there in the summer, and they have a right to use water to clear out the water there, but also create a downstream base flow. As part of our well permits, there are triggers that many people may be familiar with, levels of the reservoir that at certain points require us to limit our well use.
Now, you've created a great visual on the website that I've just recently seen that actually shows the different levels, it shows where we're at, it talks about the different stages. Can you talk to us a little bit about that great new visual for people?
Sure, absolutely. Last year, we had stage restrictions, and we did enforcement along the way. And we talked to people about how we could better get word out to make sure people understood the water situation in the town, why we were doing what we were doing, and what the issues were overall. And one of the things mentioned was improving our website. Mm-hmm. So we worked with our engineer and town staff, Regita Perimetla and Roy. They worked together, and they came up with some great information that we put up there that's updated pretty much on a daily basis. And really, the trigger, as Roy has mentioned as well, is that elevation of the reservoir.
Now, where does the elevation get measured?
We have a sensor that goes from one of the well houses. We have. Let me back up a little. It's all set up by something called the SCADA system, which is the computer system, of course. Then there's a line that goes into the reservoir itself, and it's pretty much, it sends a signal and gives us a height. Yep. So it's set at the bottom of the reservoir, one of the deeper spots. It's about 140 feet out, and it sends a signal, and that's where we get our height. So that's why they're so accurate. You'll see point something all the time. That's why we can get that accuracy. And 2 years ago, we had a dive team come in and verify that it was working correctly and was set correctly, so we know that our levels are correct.
Good, good. Now, the MWRA connection, people have been talking about that. Thoughts, I know we approved reviewing it moving forward. Where is that review process at in regards to what people can potentially see maybe at a November town meeting?
Sure. So at the last town meeting, absolutely, we reviewed or we approved the idea of joining the MWRA and moving forward. Right now we're focusing on the permitting piece is one piece of that. And so part of the process of joining is because we are requesting the potential use of over 1 million gallons a day, there's a statewide process through the Massachusetts Environmental Policy, or MEPA Act, that allows a number of different state agencies to comment on our application. Okay. So it's a very transparent process that's run at the state level to make sure that a wide variety of stakeholders can have input. So it's a 2 to 3 step process. We send in a draft summary of what we'd like to do. We get comments back on that. Then we send in a draft report, final report, and then we send in the final report on that. So we're in the process of that right now. The second piece is we want to get residents involved in a committee to come up with recommendations for the selectmen regarding water policies, I'm sure you're familiar with as well.
Right, and that's a committee that we are still looking for some people to, either with environmental background or water background or conservation background, to come and be part of that committee.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's great. Yeah. So as soon as that committee is up and running, which we hope to get up this month, we'll start having some meetings and talk about policy. Because I think one key component here is the idea that the use of the water really will be set by the selectmen as advised by the committee.
Right.
And bylaws are set by town meeting. So there's a very public process here.
Right, right.
And the actual water source, we just want to make sure there's enough water for the needs, but how the water is used is not our decision, it's the decision of the residents.
Right.
And one of the things I get a lot of calls on when I get calls about the connection, which I get quite a few a week, I believe it's a misconception. So a lot of people think we're switching to MWRA permanently. We're not. It's just a supplement water source. We'll continue to use our wells as long as we can. It's just so we don't have those stage one, stage two interruptions, so it's more of an even flow. So a lot of people think that we're tying in completely, and that's a misconception.
Now, is there, and this would be a long-term concern possibly, that our wells would no longer be allowed to be used? I mean, is that something we have to be, I don't know. I mean, I'm just asking. Is that something we might have to be concerned about at some point?
It's a good question.
Yeah, it's a tough, I mean, eventually if our source gets worse to the point, again, we have very shallow wells. We don't have 100, 200, 300 foot wells.
Right.
Ours are in the 30 foot range. And they have been, we've had times where we've been to almost airborne levels. Mm-hmm. I mean, as time goes on and water tables shift and aquifers shift, there's a chance our wells may go dry and we can't use them. Then, yeah, we'd have to switch completely. But until then, I don't believe it's going to be something we're just going to say, let's get rid of our well system. Okay. Or the state's going to say, well, you're tied to MWRA, that's it. That, I don't believe, will happen that way. It has to be something dramatic that caused the wells to fail.
Now, would it be possible to replace some of the shallower wells with deeper wells, or is that controlled by the DEP?
It's the way our plant was designed, technically. Mm-hmm. It just, those were the source areas where we were getting the aquifer water.
Right.
It was coming at the pace we needed. You know, it was set, that was as deep as we needed to go. When they designed this plant, at the time. The source before that was the old WACA-TV wells, of course, mm-hmm. you know. And then when they shifted over there, they had the old plant that was there originally had only two pump houses. Now we have five.
Right.
And that plant's been in operation almost 13, 14 years now. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you came in when the plant came in?
I came in about 6 months after the plant was built, yes.
Okay.
And it was state of the art. And it's still, we're always upgrading. That's another thing. We always try to keep up with the upgrades, the equipment, the better technologies, better filtrations. We're always doing something there.
Well, that's good to hear, because I know that's the other thing people will ask, mm-hmm. you know, where, you know, you see your sewer rates go up and you see your water rates go up, and where does it go to? Mm-hmm. And to know that current technology and best practices are being used, that's a very positive thing.
Yep, the town's water department actually won a state award 3 years ago for quality and even staffing.
Wow, a state award. Congratulations.
We have a state award for that. Yeah. So we're very proud of our plant, our distribution, our staffing. I mean, our guys are always knowledgeable. They're always getting training. I mean, countless classes, training, countless license upgrades, new equipment, how to use it. So they're always out there doing something with it.
And we have good water quality. I mean, you can turn the water on at the sink and feel
very
comfortable
proud of it.
I
do.
Yeah.
I drink it.
Yeah.
Very proud of it.
Good. So last thing before we go, Dave, can you just remind people what the new Stage 1 and Stage 2 restrictions are? Because we voted
them
in May.
Yes.
But they weren't put into place right away because they had to be approved. So are we in those new restrictions yet?
Not quite yet.
Okay. When will those go into place?
As soon as the Attorney General approves our bylaws from the town meeting. So it's imminent. So
okay.
It's
so
a great
tell
question.
Us what the current ones are, and then tell us what the new ones will be.
So there's sort of two pieces to it. Currently, we have year-round restrictions, which are odd-even. So if your house number is an odd number, then you water Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday.
Okay, if your house hold on. I just want to repeat that. Odd equals Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday. Okay.
Even equals Wednesday, Friday, Sunday.
Even is Wednesday, Friday, Sunday, and no one gets to water on Monday.
That's correct.
Okay. Got it.
And a clarification that Roy always reminds me of, because I forget it too, is if you water on a Tuesday, that's Tuesday from 7 p.m. till Wednesday morning at
7 a.m.
To 7 a.m.
Yeah. Right.
It's a 12-hour window.
It's a 12-hour window.
Okay.
You're correct. You're correct. So it's into the next day.
So I'm an odd-numbered house, so I can start watering Tuesday at 7 p.m. up until Wednesday at 7 a.m.
Yes. That's correct.
Okay.
That's correct.
And something that we run into a lot of the times when the season starts, we run into a lot of people watering the wrong day. And the reason they do that, even though it's their day, is from 7 p.m. to midnight, you're watering on your day, but your timer doesn't know the difference between a.m. and p.m., so they set it for Tuesday morning instead of Wednesday morning.
Oh,
so you have to remember the p.m. cutoff. So from 7 p.m., let's say it's Tuesday, from 7 p.m. to midnight, it's Tuesday.
Right.
Then from midnight to 7 a.m., you have to set your timer for Wednesday morning.
Right.
So it's something that happens quite a bit, you know.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So those are the current regulations. We
That's
can
correct.
All water three times a week.
Mm-hmm.
And what are the new ones going
to
be?
The new regulations, it'll be twice a week.
Okay.
With the current regulations, we have two stages of increasing restrictions.
Mm-hmm.
At the first stage, you can do hand watering. At the second stage, no outdoor watering.
Okay.
With the new regulations, at the first stage and in most cases, at the second stage, you will still be able to irrigate once a week.
Okay.
So our idea there is, broadly, year-round, we're reducing from 3 to 2.
Mm-hmm.
But for those folks who have put in new plants or have a significant investment they want to maintain, getting that once a week deep watering,
right.
Maybe you can supplement it with a rain barrel, something to keep mm-hmm. it going, will hopefully be enough to keep things going.
Okay, good. And when will we find out about the Attorney General?
It's a great question. The town clerk always notifies us as soon as we hear, so imminently. We think probably in the next few weeks.
And that'll be put up on that new website that you guys
Absolutely.
Have created?
Okay,
exactly. Good. So, Roy, before I let the two of you go, and Dave has had to answer this question, I have a question. It's not very tough, though. So, one question I ask new guests is there something about you, Roy, that people in Ashland may not know that you're willing to share?
Well, I like to restore old furniture. I'm a big fan of doing that. I'm actually one of those people who drive down the street, see something on the side of the road, and see something in it that nobody did when they're throwing it out. So I can spend days just restoring. So I'll picture what it's going to look like at the end. I have a garage full of old furniture.
And restored. Then what do you do with that old furniture?
I give it to, well, first when people see it, they can't believe I even picked it up. And then after, I usually give it to somebody who really wants it.
Uh-huh.
I just give it away. It's more of the challenge to rebuild it or restore it. So it's my hobby, it's my relaxation. I like to do that.
Well, that's great. Yeah, so if I ever find an old piece, I can ask you to
Absolutely.
Restore it?
Absolutely.
Sounds
Absolutely.
Good.
Absolutely. Love to do it.
Good. Well, gentlemen, thank you for coming on Around
thank
the
you
Clock.
For
I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, that's it for this section of Around the Clock. Stay tuned, and we'll be back with more.
Coach Kaiser here with a fit tip for you. Stay away from products that promise you rapid weight loss or magic transformation in record time. They don't work in the long run, and what you need to do is doing great things for you short and long run of everyday life.
Welcome back to Around the Clock. Even though people don't want to think about it, it is going to be back to school at the end of August, and that leads us to some of the programs that are going on in our schools. And today I have with me Melissa Green. Melissa, welcome to Around the Clock.
Thank you.
Melissa is from Safe Routes to School, a program based in Massachusetts that talks about how you can get to school safely. But Melissa, I'm going to let you talk a little bit more about it. Tell
Great.
Us a little bit about Safe Routes to School.
Great. So Safe Routes to School is a program of the Department of Transportation. So we're encouraging students to walk and bike to school safely. So the program has 5 E's that we focus on. So we have education, encouragement, enforcement, evaluation, engineering. And through these 5 E's, we are kind of helping to increase physical activity and health among students while also decreasing air pollution and traffic around schools.
And how is that program, or how is your job related to what's going on here in Ashland?
Yeah, so at Safe Routes to School, we work all across the state. So I work in the Central Mass Territory as the outreach coordinator here. So I've been working in Ashland. And I work to develop the programs with whatever the community wants. So here in Ashland, the partners are Henry Warren, David Mendez, and Ashland Middle School. And they signed on in about March 2014, and we've developed a Safe Routes to School task force with representation from parents, administrators, school committee, board of selectmen, law enforcement, to kind of create a sustainable program in the community. And so the goal of the task force is to kind of advocate for healthy transportation while also kind of identifying the barriers that are preventing kids from walking to school. So we developed that last fall, and this spring we implemented one of our first programming, which was a Walking Wednesday series at the David Mendez School. So that let parents drop their kids off at the Montenegro Square, and they could join their friends and walk the rest of the way to school. So that was kind of a neat opportunity for students that don't live close enough to school to walk to kind of get the active and healthy alternative transportation to getting to school while also reducing the traffic on Mendez that morning.
And why did you target the Mendez School for this Walking Wednesday program?
Yeah, so with Safe Routes to School, we work with elementary and middle, but we find that kind of the third through fifth age group is kind of the best target age group. So when they're younger, they can't necessarily walk the whole distance, or their, you know, cognitive awareness isn't always fully there of, you know, if a car is coming, how far, long will it take till they get mm-hmm. there? So it's perfect that the schools are here divided up by these age groups, because the third through fifth is the perfect age to focus on. And we did find a route that, the task force did find a route that kind of had a sidewalk going all the way for a short distance.
Now, also part of Safe Routes to School, we did a program at the Warren School mm-hmm. for the second graders. Can you talk a little bit about that program?
Yeah, sure. So as part of Safe Routes, I mentioned the five E's, one of them being education. So we offer a pedestrian safety education. So this one we target for second graders. We have done different age groups, but here at the Warren School, we did the second grade pedestrian safety education, where we had a bunch of parent volunteers, and we trained the second graders how to be safe on a parking lot, sidewalk, and then crossing the street. So it was kind of like a little mini walking education field trip for them.
And then the hope is that those second graders who learn those skills, one, will just use them in general,
right.
but two, maybe then when we start walking Wednesdays right. again in the fall, will want to join us now that they're going up to the Mindos.
Right, I think the vertical integration of the education is important in Ashland, so it's kind of a good tie-in with the program we're doing in Mindos.
Okay, so that's the next thing to talk about. Mm-hmm. We had three walking Wednesdays in the spring. They were fairly mm-hmm. well attended, and we're going to continue them in the fall. Can you talk a little bit about the program for the fall?
Sure. So in the spring, we did three walking Wednesdays, about 25 people average on each walk. So in the fall, we're going to be doing a walking series as well. I think we decided on six Wednesdays again in the fall. One of them will be falling on International Walk to School Day, which is a big walk to school day that all across the country students are participating in. So we kind of wanted to take the momentum of the last spring and start it up in the fall again.
And you work with Lisa Bowden. She's one.
Yes.
She's the main contact for you.
Mm-hmm.
She ties it into her nutritional services, mm-hmm. And then how do you see the nutrition and the walking? How do those work together in your mind?
Yeah. Well, I think that nutrition has, from my understanding from Lisa, has kind of been a really big focus lately. And in many schools, actually the Mindes does have a very good PE program, but it's also students need 60 minutes of exercise each day. So by walking to school in the morning or after school, it's an easy way to just, you know, check off those minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So it just, it kind of, by eating healthy in the school cafeterias and getting exercise in PE and outside of PE, walking to school is kind of creating a healthier kid, and studies have shown that active kids and healthy, physically active kids can tie into academic performance.
And is there a place, if someone wants to read up more on Safe Routes to School, is there a website that they could go check out?
Yeah, so it's part of the Massachusetts Department of Transportation website, so commute.com, and then there's a tab for Safe Routes. And then actually, Safe Routes is also a national program, so there's a national Safe Routes to School website as well.
Now, before I let you go, first of all, I understand you're not feeling well,
yeah.
so that's too bad, but thank you for being here anyway.
Yeah.
One of the questions I ask people that come on the show when it's their first time, and
okay.
I'm sure this will be an easy one for you, is there something about you, Melissa Green, that most people who are watching don't know, and for most people this is their first time meeting you, that you are willing to share? Something about you that
wow.
people may not know that you'd be willing to share with our viewers.
Okay. Kind of tough, but I guess I'd say I'm also into art, so I do a lot of drawing and painting, so that's something that doesn't come across in my work life, so I guess that could be something.
Okay, well, that's great. And what I find when I ask people these questions,
yeah.
you're looking at someone and sometimes what they come out with is completely opposite of who
right.
you know when you're sitting
yeah.
there talking to them. So
yeah.
that makes perfect sense.
You yeah.
have that artistic side.
Yeah.
Well, Melissa, thank you for being here. I look forward to walking with you again
yeah,
in the fall
definitely.
For Safe Routes to School. Well, that's it for this section of Around the Clock. Stay with us and we'll be back with a little bit more. Take care. Come join us for Yoga in the Park on Friday, August 28th from 6 to 7:30 at the gazebo at Stone Park. The class is a fundraiser to help raise money for the fireworks for the 30th Ashland Day celebration. The cost, $10 per person, $5 for children, and a $20 cap for families. You can also purchase a t-shirt for $20 and use that as your ticket to get into the class. Tickets and t-shirts are available at the Red Dress in downtown Ashland.
Welcome back to Around the Clock. It's time for our Around the Town tour. And even though it's summer, there's still lots going on here in Ashland. We had a planning board presentation, and they had their first hearing about the 466 Chestnut project. And that's the project that's going in a corner of Chestnut Street and Elliott Street. The developers, Green Development, came in and gave a presentation on what they're looking to have the development look like. It will all be senior residential housing with some nice landscaping. And the great part about this project is that it will not be affecting the corner of Chestnut and Elliott Street. So the view from Warren Woods, which is across the street, will not be affected. If you're interested, you can go to the ashlandmass.com website, sign up for Co-Urbanize, and keep up to date on that project as well as other projects going on here in Ashland. It's summer, and that means the farmers market in Ashland. As always, we have our trusty team going out every Saturday and checking in on what's going on in the market. We've had dog days, we've had all kinds of fun and exciting, interesting things going on at the farmers market. So let's take a look at what they've seen.
Hi, I'm Toyin Yusuf. So I hear today is the whole big dog day. So tell us about that.
Today is the Farmers Market Dog Days of August competition. It consists of dogs registering in two different categories, large dogs and small dogs, over and under 40 pounds. And what I do is I judge them on their behavior, on their gait, on their personality, and other criteria that's used in the professional dog shows. But of course, it's here in Ashland, and we love our mongrels as much as we love our purebreds. So we don't preface what they are. As long as they're well behaved and they like to be with people and other dogs, we're happy to evaluate them.
If you've been in downtown recently, you've probably noticed all the great changes going on at the Needham Bank. They've renovated the building from what it used to look like. They've upgraded the landscaping and the lighting and the sidewalks. They had their official ribbon cutting ceremony on July 29th. A number of members from the bank were there, as well as the Metro West Chamber of Commerce and a number of people from Ashland. It was a great celebration, and if you haven't been in yet, go and take a look. The bank looks very different from your usual bank. The design, the feel, and everyone was very welcoming. So go ahead, check it out. They'd be happy to show you the bank. Plus, they've been a real great community partner. They are working with the farmers market, and people who open bank accounts, a donation will be made to the farmers market on their behalf.
Opening in Ashland is a really important opportunity and a challenge for us. The opportunity in the minds of our management team is to immerse ourselves, and it's a big opportunity here in Ashland. The challenge is proving ourselves to the community, and we sincerely welcome both the opportunity and the challenge. Our first month in Ashland has been very, very encouraging. We've met a lot of really nice people who care deeply about the community. We've opened a lot of new accounts. and we appreciate each and every one of them.
We're thrilled to have Needham Bank here in town, and Denise has been already incredible with all of her brainstorming for how to help small businesses, and so there's going to be some very exciting programs coming out that's going to be really beneficial to Ashland's economic growth, so we're really thrilled they're here.
One, two, three, cut!
Another new business in town is on the other side of town, and this is the Residence at Valley Farm. This is a senior housing, senior home, residential, just next to Shaw's. They had a Christmas in July party, and they were showing tours of what some of the facility is going to look like. They showed us their memory care units and just the wood, just a very nicely designed residence. So if you know someone who would like to stay in Ashland but has had not the opportunity to find a place like this, check out the Residence at Valley Farm. We have our ever-popular summer concerts, and July 28th was a real popular one. It was the Beatles cover band, and they were great. The kids loved them. There was a lot of dancing and energy, a very big crowd for that concert, and we were able to catch it all on camera. Take a look.
One, two, three. Please.
WACA does not only produce cable shows like this one and some of the other great shows that are produced here, but they also offered a film and acting workshop for students to learn how to act on film. They're also running a video camp, so students who are interested in learning how to use video cameras can write a story and videotape it. And then those students are sometimes invited to then work for the cable station during the school year and through the summer to videotape and record sports games or events. So the next time you see someone recording and they're from WACA-TV, they might have gone through the video camp that happens here.
You got the money? Let's meet tomorrow.
Half of them want you locked up.
Smith here. John Smith. What is it?
Unidentified female.
It's strange. Very similar wounds.
Good afternoon, Gregor.
Detective? Same insignia.
The man.
The man?
I know there's something else.
Last time there'll be any trucks in this town.
So even though it's summer in Ashland and many people are off on vacation, many people are still hard at work. You'll see our employees working, but also our volunteers. And one of the volunteer committees that are working right now is the Override Study Committee. They have been starting to have forums for community members and public to come and give their input and ask their questions as to what an override might mean for Ashland. Mike Herbert and Tony Schiavi, as well as Jim Adams and Barbara Durant, are presenting information about what an override might look like, what kinds of benefits we would have from having that additional revenue. And also, it's a listening time to hear from the community, say, what do they think, what do they want as values, and what do they want Ashland to look like, and how are people or are people willing to pay for it? Take a look at one of the forums that was held.
Most of you probably remember during the budget deliberations this year, the members of the tri-board were going through the future financial year's situation. And it looked like, you know, we have a looming structural deficit over the next 5 years. And so that's when really the members of these three committees, to remind you, the Finance Committee, Board of Selectmen, and the School Committee said, you know, what are we going to do over the next 5 years given this analysis? And one of the things, one of the options that we're looking at is an override. So, and that started this process of which the public outreach, where we're giving out the information that we have and asking for input and asking for observations and questions is really an important part. This is the first of what will be several public forums. This one was, we invited members of town committees. So that's the basically how we got to where we're at right now. And So without further ado, I'm going to turn this over to Michael Herbert for his presentation, and after that we'll get into questions and answers.
Well, that's it for our Around the Clock, Around the Town tour for this show. But this is being filmed early in August, and there's all kinds of things coming up before we film again in September. So make sure you're on the lookout for the Dragonfly Festival, which will be coming up in August on August 15th, held at the Ashland Historical Society's building. Also, it'll be back to school before we know it at the end of August, and school starts September 2nd, so be on the lookout for those yellow school buses. Of course, the Override Study Committee will have a few more sessions, so try to put one of those on your calendar at some point. Then here at WACA-TV, we have a new mini-series coming out. It's called The Interns. It was written by Joe White from Ashland Community Theater. And believe it or not, it's a show about a news station. You'll have to check it out when it airs. And last but not least, Barbara Chisholm will be representing WACA-TV as she attends the Alliance for Community Media. They have a... Alliance for Community Media, okay. And last but not least, Barbara Chisholm will be representing WACA-TV at the conference held by the Alliance for Community Media. Our show, one more time. And last but not least, Barbara Chisholm will be representing WACA-TV and Around the Clock as she attends the conference sponsored by the Alliance for Community Media. Our year in review was represented and submitted to the competition, and it won for all-around news program. We're very proud of that accomplishment, and we thank you for watching our show. Welcome back to Around the Clock. We have a very special segment for you today. We are getting to do something we've never done here yet on Around the Clock. We are getting to introduce a brand new album. It is called Foundations, and it is by Ashland's own Jesse Hansen, who is here to speak with us today. Jesse, welcome to Around the Clock, and congratulations on the album. I know you're very excited.
Thank you. I am. This is true. This is a very true statement.
So this is your second album. Mm-hmm. Before we get to this one, let's talk a little bit about your first album. Okay. And I've known you for a while. I got to meet you your senior year of high school. You were singing and performing as part of chorus and doing some great things. And it's been great and great fun for me to be able to sort of follow your career. So take us a little bit childhood. How did you get into music?
So I started playing classical violin at age 3 and a half.
Okay.
It was a little bit of an early riser there. And my parents are very, very musical, and they had a bluegrass band. My mom plays bass, my dad plays a little bit of everything. And my eldest brother is a professional musician now, and he was playing drums, you know, growing up. So it was just like everywhere, constantly. Mm-hmm. And it was like very much a big part of my life, playing classical violin.
Okay.
Yeah. And so that's kind of where it all started. But I didn't do anything really else except for classical violin until I was a teenager, until I was 15. I had never even sung before until I was like 15.
And what made you change, or what made you decide to try something different?
So I love classical music, but it's a very intense lifestyle and all of that, and I kind of was getting less and less interested in it, and it was almost like an identity crisis because I had been doing it for so long.
Yeah.
And then I remember I was jamming with like one of my best friends at the time, who was a really, really great guitarist, and he was in a rock band, and he was like, we should jam, we should write songs together. So we kind of just started. And then we started jamming with a couple other friends from Ashland, and they were like, we were going like, we need somebody to sing these songs, and the bassist was kind of like, oh, I guess I'll do it, and he started singing, and I was like, no, we can't have this. So that's like how it started.
So you jumped in and started singing.
Yeah.
Okay.
And playing guitar and stuff like that, kind of finding other uses for all this knowledge I had accumulated.
Right.
Yeah.
So graduation, those of us who know you were at graduation, you got to perform in class day,
Right. Then
you got to sing your song at graduation. And Right. By the way, that tradition of taking something from class day and having it perform on graduation now has continued. So you started a great tradition.
I know, it's hard to believe sometimes, but I've caught a couple of the graduation clips on WACA, and it's like, every time I see it, it's like, oh my gosh. Did I do that?
You did, but it's a great tradition. So
I love it.
Graduation, yeah. Take us from there.
So what happened, kind of taking it back a little bit, is when I was a senior in high school, I was like dead set on going to Berklee College of Music. My eldest brother had gone through, had graduated and everything, and you know, my parents always, they told me, you know, if you get into the school, we'll help you get there. And so I auditioned, and I got in, and I got a scholarship and everything, and I was like stoked. I was done. You know, yeah. I had only applied to another school as like a safety. I was so set on it. And then come April, a few things just fell through. Berklee's a very expensive school, and it was only a partial scholarship. There was kind of just no way to make it work. And I was thinking like, well, if music is what I want to do, I'm going to do it. And my brother was out in LA, and you know, my parents and I have been talking about, you know, kind of hooking up with them and using them as a resource. So what happened is that at graduation, you know, this whole thing happened with the song These Words.
Yep.
And you know, Miss Hammond over at Ashland High, she let me arrange this whole thing with the chorus, and then we did it for class day, and it just got such an overwhelming response that it kind of launched my spirit in some way or another in order to just go for it. So I actually left for Los Angeles, I think 3 days after graduation.
Wow.
And my brother and I just started working on this album of tunes that I had written kind of over my high school years. Some were tunes that I wrote with my band, my high school band, but the others were tunes that I wrote, and I was still writing stuff. So that was
the And what was the name of your first album?
Back to Boston.
Okay, and when did that finally get released?
So that got released in January of 2013.
So not even a year after graduation.
No, not even. I don't like to waste time.
Jump right in. Yeah. Good for you.
Yeah, I'm kind of a little bit of a taskmaster, but...
Yeah. Okay, so after that album, because it's been almost 2 years since that album. So take us through between that album release and what you've been doing since.
So that album was released, and the response was just, it was really, really great. A lot of people still remembered these words from graduation, so that had a really strong response, and people have been very, very supportive. And then, you know, when I released the whole album, it was actually garnering some attention from, like I got a letter from the people from So You Think You Can Dance, and they were interested in using my song. And so it's just like, and then I started meeting people through it too, because I was playing shows and all this stuff. So it's just like, you know, one thing led to another, and, you know, I've had just the most amazing experiences meeting people from all over the country, all over the world, actually. And then being able to, most recently, I went on tour in Europe last fall.
Yeah, I remember hearing about that.
Yeah, and that was pretty wild.
How many countries? How many performances?
10 countries, something like 10 countries, and I think around 35 to 40 performances.
Wow, and good reception, good response.
Yeah, the Germans are all over it. Yeah, they were great. I mean, the audiences there are so different than they are here. Mm-hmm. Like here, everybody's like, you know, they want to be involved in the music and they want to, you know, be a part of it and stuff like that. But in Europe, it's such an audience versus performer dynamic, and they sit there and they just absorb everything. So like when you're me and you're an acoustic artist, and sometimes when you're playing in bars, it's kind of like hard to grab people's attention.
Right.
They like came to the bars to sit down and watch you, and it was amazing. And they would like come up after the show, and everybody speaks English, of course.
Right.
So, you know, they would come up and made a lot of friends that way.
Oh, good, good. So that was last fall.
Yeah.
So how long did it take you to make this second album?
So we did a Kickstarter for this, which I think we launched in like November, and it took us a month to raise the funds. And then I went out to Los Angeles to record the foundational tracks, like the bass, the drums, and rhythm guitar and stuff like that, with my brother and a friend of my brother's, and we did it in like this really nice studio called Boulevard Recording. It's where Pink Floyd did The Wall and stuff like that. You know, like
lots of history.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Ray Charles used to record there. Really cool. So we started it in December. Then I came back here in Massachusetts and worked with a friend of mine who has a home studio, and we just did the rest of the tracking from January until, I don't know, like May, and then we mixed, mastered it, and now it is done.
You had a couple of fun things in between. I had the opportunity to see you perform at TEDx Amherst out of UMass Amherst, which was a fabulously cool performance and venue.
Yeah. And that was something.
You've had other things since then or other performances?
Oh, yeah. Well, actually, it's been kind of slow this summer because I've been so focused on gearing up for the album release. I mean, nothing compares to TED. It's not like I went and played another TED conference.
Right, right.
That was really, really cool. But yeah, like little festivals here and there, and then come the fall, I'm going to have a lot more shows going on with the album coming up.
So you're having an album release party. When is that?
So it's August 22nd at Amazing Things in Framingham.
And the album is Foundations.
Mm-hmm.
So they can go to the Amazing Things website and get tickets. And go have some fun and hear all this live. You also did a video for one of the songs locally recently.
Yeah.
Invited a bunch of your old friends from what I heard. And
I mean, it was a blast. I mean, it's probably the most fun I've had kind of doing anything related to my music career in a while. Because I basically just got like a bunch of my favorite people from my graduating class and then some. And we all got together and I literally wrote, you know, in the invitation, I was like, you know, dress up as rednecks. Let's get the persona going. Bring flannel. You know, and everybody delivered, and so it was such a blast.
Well, I just think it's great. You know, congratulations.
Thank
you. You're doing what you want to do. You're making it happen. Before I let you go, first thing is next steps after this album release. Bunch of performances.
Yeah.
What are the plans?
So after the CD release at Amazing Things, I have quite a few Boston area shows going on, like full band. You know, we're gonna have actually an 8-piece band at this Amazing Things show. It's gonna be like, we have a 3-piece horn section and everything. It's gonna be good. So we're doing a bunch of shows like in the area, and I'm doing a brief tour with another singer songwriter. We're kind of going down south and for a couple weeks. And then, you know, what's so cool is that with Back to Boston, I mean, I released it, I had no idea what to expect, and it's like, you know, I met the people that I met because of it, and I went to the places that I went to because of it, and it's, I just have no idea what's going to happen with this, but I am relocating indefinitely to Los Angeles in January, so I'm going to be living and working with my brother and kind of as, you know, I almost want to say business partners, because he does everything that I can't. He does the engineering, the production, the rhythm sections, and I do all the, you know, strings. And
so it's just easier to make your home base out there and do it all.
Yeah, and just, you know, see what comes of it. But, you know, it's been such a fun experience, because this was actually my first, like, totally self-produced project, too. Mm-hmm. You know, with the last album, my brother was really, like, guiding me through the whole thing, and it was his first production with the Back to Boston, and so we both just learned so much, and actually ever since that album he's been working as a producer out in LA.
Cool. So you sort of helped him launch his second career as well.
We can look at it that
way. There you
way.
Go.
I don't know.
He might not agree,
might
but
not
that's
agree.
Okay.
But with this one, it's like, you know, he helped me organize like the players at first, but then once it came back to Massachusetts, it's like, ask anybody I worked with, like I became the taskmaster.
There you go. Well, you know what? If you want to get something done, if you have a vision of what you want.
Right.
So I have one last question. When I have new guests on Around the Clock, I have one question for them. And that question is there something about you, Jesse Hansen, that not many people know that you'd be willing to share? I always have to add that you'd be willing to share, because I don't want anyone to embarrass themselves unless they really want to. So
it's so funny that you asked that question, because actually I thought of an answer for that exact question today, because it just occurred to me. So here's the thing, is that I get really, some of my friends, my dad, they call me like a human barometer, because I get really, really bad headaches whenever the weather pressure changes.
Ooh.
And I get this like weird kind of feeling like something's off. And so actually earlier today, I was at home and suddenly I just got this really bad migraine, and it got so bad that I actually had to like get back in bed.
Oh,
and I had
no.
to drink coffee, because caffeine really helps with my headaches. And I go, like, something's off. And so I check my weather app, and it's like we had a microburst today, you know?
The storm was unbelievable.
Yeah, there was like hail and everything. Yeah. So I'm kind of like an X-Men in that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, so if we ever need to check the weather and we can't get to our computers, we can check with you.
Right. If I have a headache, you know, grab your umbrellas.
Good. Well, Jesse, it was great having you on the show. Continued good luck with your career and
with your
music. Again, the album is Foundations. The album release party is happening on August 22nd at Amazing Things in Framingham. I would recommend you go listen if you've never heard Jesse live. It is quite the experience. Anyway, that's it for this section of Around the Clock. Stay tuned and we'll be back. We'll be right back.
Well, that's it for this episode of Around the Clock. Thanks for watching, and see you in September.